champions. Like, all memes aside, people are talking about how his Azir is meh, but then his Ryze was really his standout champion at MSI, and he was able to actually affect the lane and not have to wait for those gigantic team fights later. He was actually able to control the pace of a game with that champion.
Yep, but by contrast, this draft looks a little bit better for NRG as well. You know, like looking at where they're picking things now and the state of the bans, this feels a little bit safer. You know almost certainly that Ryze is going into the mid lane for HuHi, which means you can delay pick if you're willing to pick another mid laner. You don't want to go for the Karma mid. And honestly, in professional play, she's like 4 to 5 times as common in support as she is mid lane. So it's actually kind of rare to see her go there. But either way, I think NRG have plenty of options. Again, they can flex the trundle. And it wasn't that I think Quas really getting smashed that hard on the one-on-one. I think there were extenuating circumstances where he never really got ahead. And I think that matchup can work for him.
I'm very surprised by the Elise ban both times as well from NRG. I feel like that's a slot you can use on something like a Ryze or something you don't really want to play against. And I know that you're a big fan of target bans, like the allowed.
I mean, if it makes sense, but if it was their best option.
Yeah, but you're still leaving things up like Nidalee, which, you know, Xmithie's shown that he's rather good on.
Yeah. And if you're not actually hurting what they're doing, I agree.
And they got Rek'Sai last game anyway, right? So yeah. CLG have been able to kind of persevere through these bans, right? You ban out an S tier mid laner, well, they still get one. And then you ban out, honestly, top pick jungler, they're still going to get one. They even ban away Rek'Sai on their side, and they still get Nidalee.
Yeah, totally agree. And looks like we're going to see NRG go for the Graves once again. So still going for that burstier style, hoping they can get some carry out of Santorin, maybe, as we line up the picks right now. And NRG leaving their traditional bot lane marksman for last, as CLG have shown us, well, they're happy to play Ezreal with a Nidalee jungle and a Ryze most likely mid. So now they've got to show their matchups. At this point, NRG looking at the sort of the permutations of their picks, looks like it's Trundle top, Lissandra mid, Karma bot lane, or Lissandra top, Karma mid, Trundle support.
Yep, just waiting on the AD carry pick, Caitlyn. Able to go through this time, was banned previously by CLG, and the Ezreal taken away. So the options for OQ, oh, he's still got the Lucian, Caitlyn. But on the other side, still have to pick another solo laner as well as a support.
They need the top lane matchup against Trundle with a Graves jungle, most likely. And I can see, actually, with GBM trying to play a counter pick style, Lissandra plus Graves can do plenty of punishment down in that mid lane and try to lock down a low mobility Ryze. He wants to bring teleport, so cleanse is less likely. Or if he brings cleanse to not die, well, now you get a TP advantage out of GBM's Lissandra. So there's things that can work really, really well here in this matchup. I think the counter picks, theoretically, can be very strong for them. Final pick for CLG ends up being Aphromoo on Alistar. Sure, fine, good pick. Even if you don't have Bard, it's still a good engage champ for him. But a Jax coming to the top lane, try to fight Trundle, which I like a lot.
Yeah, I actually really like this pick. You're going to lower some of his damage with the Chomp from Trundle, but it doesn't matter because he's mostly based off of his Empowered W and also his Relentless Assault, where he's just able to continually get more and more stacks and attack speed and bursts of damage.
So yeah, his actual raw AD is pretty
low.
Irrelevant, honestly.
Yeah, that's actually a great way to put it. And the Jax was banned previously, so you know that NRG are a bit afraid of it and how Quas is going to hold up in that one-on-one, because he ended up losing it later in the game in that Fiora-Trundle matchup. Previously.
Yeah, absolutely. So the pick's going to come through, and it will be the Jhin coming in for OQ. Ashe was still available, but instead plays a different sort of utility-focused AD carry, and it's kind of funny seeing NRG try to pull a Liquid and say, you know what, yeah, just put the bot lane in utility. We're going to play around other people instead. Let's go on this side of the map. And you know, Quas has been getting a little bit better over time. I think on day one, he was the worst top laner in the league. Now he's at least an acceptable one. You know, yeah, sure, he's still not Haunster, but I think he's been reasonable. And if GBM can get his mid game under control, then that style can work. If OQ's not laning well, you don't need him to lane well. You don't need him to carry.
Yeah.
Give it to Santorin. That's what he's trying to do with the Graves.
Exactly. They're giving him the Graves, and I think that may be why they're banning the Elise, because the Thunderlord's Graves against Elise gets destroyed early on. You don't have enough HP.
Yeah.
And you try to burst her down, but if she lands a cocoon, you're pretty much done
for.
You
just kind of die.
Yeah, even mid-game, right? Because you don't have that same type of resilience. Anyway, the team compositions, little bit lacking wave clear on CLGs. They have a Jax, but then the Ezreal Ryze, you're going to have to blow your Ryze ultimate most of the time to get that wave clear down. So allowing Darshan room to split push is going to be slightly difficult.
Yeah.
But then on the other side, NRG, actually, I like their composition here. They have the lock
Graves
up in the Lissandra.
Really volatile.
Jhin was a fantastic pick for OQ. He's only played it once, and he was deathless on it. So them setting up those types of fights with the Jhin ultimate and also using Santorin as a damage dealer, it could be really good moving forward for NRG in this game.
Absolutely. So we'll see if it works out now well for NRG as they try to bounce back in game two. So let us know who it's going to be. Get on Twitter. Let us know who's going to be. Who's going to take the W? Hashtag CLG win. Hashtag NRG win. Online. You know how it is. We talk about it every time. I want you to, let us know who it's going to be. Game one was a pretty close vote, but CLG took it convincingly once the 8-minute mark rolled around. NRG had one trick up their sleeve, and then that was kind of it for their bag of tricks. They had nothing else to really pull out there, and CLG just played smart, controlled League of Legends. Now, we do have a quick pause in this one, so we're not going to get into the game just yet, but we'll let you know when it updates. But yeah, as we were mentioning...
I actually want to touch on two things here, because the champion select was actually very dynamic. The Ryze came out, and then you talked about how you really want to take cleanse against Lissandra, but HuHi is a teleport mid laner pretty much through and through. He loves to be able to affect the map with that spell, and he's taken it once again here. So having that summoner spell and not having the cleanse makes him a good target for the Santorin ganks after level 6. And then in the bottom lane, they got Karma against Alistar. So you're probably going to lane swap it if you're CLG.
Yeah.
And so NRG have an opportunity here to possibly call that. And they've been very creative in their lane swaps as well as their post-lane swaps.
Definitely agree. And, CLG traditionally known as a great lane swap team, but NRG had gotten the better of them ever so slightly in their own choices over in game one. Thinking about, we talk about mid lane having some level of priority because GBM can wave clear very well. We know the gank assist from Santorin can be excellent with the chain CC and to the crazy damage that Thunderlord's Graves will actually deal.
Once again, Thunderlords.
Yep, Thunderlord's Graves, right? Scary stuff right there. A lot of armor pen, a lot of damage. And you got OQ and Kiwikid who probably have an advantage matchup as well in the 2-on-2. And okay, sure, Ezreal can sit there and farm with Mystic Shots, but he'll be pushing under his turret the whole time. And Aphromoo on Alistar, not going to get a whole lot done under his turret either. The question is... top lane is the only lane kind of left to sort of talk about with this one. And Jax versus Trundle, I feel like, is still pretty close. Once again, it's CLG looking at the matchup and then picking their own champion, so you assume it should be Darshan favored. He won the matchup last time when he played Fjord into the Trundle. Picking a different style here, but you assume Darshan should be having the lead.
I also think if you're NRG, you assume that Darshan is going to get camped for, but you need to camp Darshan early. That's the thing. Is CLG's strategy right now is really Darshan is pivotal to how this team is going to operate. They don't really have enough wave clear to completely buy him enough time over and over again.
Yeah.
They aren't a siege team. It's not like a Ziggs or something, right? So they need to get Darshan ahead. If Darshan gets behind, which that's how NRG wins, if they
CLG
get Darshan behind, they don't have much. Mm. It's much harder to win with this team comp when that happens.
For what it's worth, I do think there's two approaches. In one of them is, try to win the 2-on-2 against Darshan, where he's kind of advantaged, but if you can peg him down, then there's no tools left for CLG. I wonder, though, if you can just get GBM so far ahead that if Darshan ever splits, he just dies with GBM roam, and the 4-on-4 is too bad for Darshan to do anything in time. But you're right, if Darshan's like 6-0, Quas just falls over and dies on respawn, so there's breaking points on either end of it. But I'm actually curious which route NRG goes for, right? Do you shore up the CLG strength or do you bolster your own?
Yeah, you have to be very decisive in this game.
Yeah.
Because you could play to almost any lane if you're NRG. You could play to GBM's lane and gank over and over again and just put GBM or put HuHi behind.
Yeah.
And put GBM ahead.
Or you can have GBM make bot lane.
Exactly. You can go bottom lane with everybody, your double teleport, but you know that CLG have double teleport as well, and they could answer you. And even if you go and gank topside, like HuHi could show up, right? So maybe ganking mid, then transitioning that to the top side is the way to go.
Yeah, we'll see if that can happen right here as we get ourselves into the lanes. And we have a nice, interesting sort of matchup where Jhin is fighting Jax 1v1, and Quas is suddenly getting surrounded on by Aphromoo and Stixxay. That will be an easy pulverize.
Yeah, it's a
bit of damage output. He should live, though.
Quas getting a little bit greedy for it, but it doesn't matter. It was tactical greed.
You don't really take damage in a lane swap anyway, so it shouldn't mean too terribly much. We get ourselves into yet again another matchup. And this time it does favor CLG, by the way. It's not a good 2-on-2 that they would have been in for Stixxay and Aphromoo, so fortunate for them to be in swapped lanes. As Xmithie takes down his blue buff and continues to run around the map with Darshan, who was able to absorb a little bit in that top side before teleporting down here. So once again, a similar play happening where they TP in to join the squad, and they knock the turret down.
And I bet Darshan's going to pick up some of the CS underneath the turret. We'll see if he gets gifted it at all, or maybe he just gets it low for Stixxay.
Yeah.
It's the typical thing to do is give it to the AD carry. But when you have a hyper carry top laner, it's not unheard of.
roster? Absolutely not. But I think it's really important that Stixxay gets enough money to get tier for himself. Mm-hmm. And if you're only getting the 100 gold from the global turret money, that's not going to give him enough. So he needs the CS.
Very true.
And I think you're not allowed to play Ezreal on a lane swap and not get tier on the first back. I think it's it's irresponsible not to manicure it that way.
I think he's going to back and get Cull.
Yeah, it looks like he's not going to be able to, actually. So
I think you back get Cull, especially since OQ started with Cull as Jhin, which is one of the worst items in the game for him because
he has very low attacks per second. Yeah.
Yeah. So on hit health doesn't mean anything.
It's much worse for him.
So, but it's about that gold. It's about scaling. I assume he's going to go with the armor penetration build like he did last time, and was all about those fourth hits and getting that gigantic crit.
Yep. And then at the end of the day, you're right. Stixxay actually gets Cull, not tier for himself. So it will be a slower stack for him. Instead, he'll get the money out of Cull, and that's the choice he went for.
HuHi shoved forward. His TP's already down.
Ooh, wow, and that's already flash gone for HuHi. He burned his early recall to get himself the tier and the teleport, but now he's got no sumps.
Yeah, you focus mid if you're Santorin. GBM, when he hits six, it's not going to be 5 minutes from now. So come back, gank HuHi again.
Yeah, in 2 minutes, GBM should be level six. If no one leeches any of your experience, the third cannon minion wave is level six, and that's right about 6 minutes into the game. So count it, put it on your watch. Minute and a half, Santorin should be back there, and it's probably HuHi kill.
And then HuHi wouldn't have TP either, so it
right,
could
he's
be
just out of
GBM.
The lane.
Even transitioning that lane to top after the lane swap is done. Nope, he's gonna use it to get back to lane. All right, so he's gonna continue to keep his pressure up. Goes for another Doran's and also the null magic mantle, so early Abyssal Scepter in the works for him.
Yeah, you got to expect that. When Xmithie walks in, a nice Rune Prison into plenty
walking
of punishment.
To Santorin.
Yeah, it's Santorin around, but now GBM is so low right after he just print teleport. Now it's much harder for him to make that fight work.
Yeah.
And what a great gank by Xmithie.
Honestly, fantastic from Xmithie. There were some wards on this side from Energy, so they believed that they were safe. And the jungler is just making the augmentation this season of showing up mid lane and trying to affect it over and over again.
But look at the damage up there. Doesn't even need level six. The double Thunderlords, goodbye to the Ryze. GBM doesn't need health to kill you off, and it happens.
Absolutely insane. Just walks up, uses the E. Well played there. HuHi too far forward, way too aggressive.
Yep.
And CLG, they're trying to play through this mid lane more and more, but I mean, Energy, if Santorin is just going to be attached to GBM, they're going to be able to do this much better at this point.
Junglers attached to their waist. Who wore it better? GBM certainly did right now. The two ganks come through. Nicely done by him. And okay, 900 gold lead for Energy. Turrets traded pretty equally. The top laners are in a similar boat, but
Darshan's going to go run and ward because it happened last time. So
he's like, I need to know what's going on here.
I got to do it this time. Whereas Quas is like, I just have a sense that I shouldn't be here. And he backs as Aphromoo is coming up from a really cheeky route.
Well, no matter how fast he runs, though, karma always catches up to you, so he's got to be careful.
And look at that, look at that.
They go around it.
They went around.
Karma is going to catch up to you.
These are really lazy wards. Like, usually you ward inside of the passes,
Darshan,
too.
He does have wards to jump to with Leaf Strike.
But it's a long lane, though.
Jump, there's the flash. Yeah, he's going to get rid of it, but there's no catch anymore, right? They burned all the movements to get there. But hey, it's Darshan burning his other trinket charge. Okay, whatever. But burning his flash, and well, now you're out of lane ones again. So Energy, you know, finding good ways to not only get GBM ahead, but try to also depress Darshan here.
Yeah, and getting his flash early in that trundle matchup can be rather big. And you can just visit him with GBM in a few minutes here. Level 6 for GBM. You have to imagine that they're going to go after HuHi and try to get pink vision control on both sides. And you can see CLG had a pink on both sides of mid lane that need to be cleared out here. So HuHi doesn't get ganked, but they're going to try to force it no matter what here on Energy side.
Well, we'll see what they can force for themselves. This top lane pushes down with Trundle, and right now Energy and Kiwi... Energy's bot lane, Kiwikid and OQ are stuck under the turret for a short time. Kind of Logic Gaming able to secure the first Drake of the game, and an early Ocean Drake is the best for them. So fortunate here for the CLG squad to lock this one down and play around getting that one. Stixxay will have a ton of mana. He's going to be happy with that one. They don't get much of the blue buff. They get 30 XP for killing a small piece of the blue.
Opposite side of the map, though. Blue buff here.
Much better take.
He's walking up. He's got to kill it now or else... Okay. Yeah, there was, Smithy was going to throw.
Yeah, 1 second late, the javelin came through. It was very, very close, actually. But nice pick by Energy. And you kind of saw that. Basically, because CLG spent the time taking the Drake, they lost control of that bot side of the map. Oh, a flash engage comes through, and GBM has nowhere to go. Flashes over the wall. He's got that where to go and does get himself away. Very tight one, but a summoner down.
Yeah, GBM, it looked like he realized right before it happened that it could happen because he started to walk to the right. He'd seen Aphromoo the entire time, and then he goes, wait a second, walks back to the left. And then Aphromoo blows his flash and engages. So GBM forced to blow his, and now HuHi has the summoner spell advantage.
Okay, we'll see if the repeat gank comes through, but the problem is CLG kind of waiting on stacking tiers right now. They're not exactly the most powerful situations. Darshan now with a wave to freeze for himself, and thankfully for CLG, there's not a lot to fight over on the map. Maybe Rift Herald later on, but they got to bring over the trundle to do that. As Quas drops the ward, kills a pink. Chomp, and down it goes. Okay, we'll see if Rift Herald ends up being the objective. Energy still sitting on an 1,100 gold lead, despite only being up one kill. So they're winning the farm game is on top of that one. You can see plus 16 on the AD carry. That's 200 gold on the Jhin. That's quite nice. Mid lane, of course, ahead thanks to the first blood. That's no big surprise.
And jungle, a little deceptive.
And a little bit
of
the jungle. Well, the assist is 200 gold, right? So that's pretty much, that's most of it. Yeah. But even, yeah, but you're right. Even after you do the math there, you still had more than that despite the farm numbers. And that's, I think a lot of that is Nidalee taking Raptors a whole lot, which are worth a bit less. Whereas, you know, Gromp and Krug actually worth a ton. And keep in mind, like, if Santorin's trying to power farm, you actually want to take Krugs and Gromp. They're worth much more XP, and they're worth more gold. So getting to those side camps is actually very valuable as a jungler.
So NRG, they think they're clever, but they're not, because they walked over a ward.
Yeah.
And you can see Aphromoo and Xmithie were waiting for it. They started sitting at that tier 2 turret. If they got, if HuHi was dove, they would have been able to reinforce that. So, energy, sniff it out, and back up.
Yeah, they're not going to lose much at all. Stixxay once again pushing in the bot side of the map here as we watch sort of CLG's map plays.
And since they're doing Rift Herald, he gets to push this wave all the way to the turret, and now you can see GBM is roaming to actually pick it up, and then they rotate OQ into mid, which I think is beautiful. And something that we don't see enough.
Right. Everyone goes one spot down, filling the other guy's position. Very nice stuff.
An actual rotation.
Right. Yeah, everyone feels over. Everyone else. Aphromoo tries, but now he's in a bad spot. Level 4 inside the pit. I'm not sure why he even tried that when Exhaust comes through, but they will try to trade on Quas, who has Flash, but the Rune Prison might be too much. No, he just barely gets out. With the buff, with the safety.
He's got to block the spear.
Xmithie wants in. Good block by Kiwikid. Flashes. Takedown's not enough. Can't land the pounds, but the auto attack comes through. So Xmithie does trade one around. And now Kiwikid, in the worst possible situation, puts the shield on. Now a block for Santorin. And actually, Kiwi lives for now. Xmithie forced to run. Rek'Sai. No, that's a teleport coming across. It's Jhin ulti. And that's going to be the snipe coming through. OQ picks up the third kill of the game for energy. Nicely done by that squad.
Yeah, it looked like there was a teleport.
Yeah, I saw
line
a red line.
Ward.
I thought it was a Rek'Sai.
It's right
of a Jhin ulti.
Yeah. Just the edge of it, yeah. And he walks right into it, too.
Yeah, so
Xmithie ends up giving over some gold there to OQ, who I believe is going for the Yomu's build, but he ended up buying the Caulfields first. Very CDR heavy at the moment. Already
it's more utility, right? It's more of a poke, not harder poke.
He already went Ionian Boots of Lucidity, too.
Right.
So, but, yep. Gets the damage off with the Runic Echoes.
Red Exhaust buys a lot of time.
It was a really good exhaust there, but unfortunately, Nidalee has a whole lot of pursuing power and almost able to get the Mantra and then the Inspire off.
Yep.
And yep. Oh.
The violins ring doom for Xmithie. He tries to juke back and forth. Stops the auto Santorin. Down he went. So, energy looking quite a bit better than they were in the previous game. Game one was still reasonably close for this stage of it.
Yeah.
They weren't ahead, but it was this kind of level of difference.
We said that at like 12 minutes.
I know.
1,000 gold advantage.
Like, all right, they're doing better than normal. But this is still sizable. This is still good for them. Up on Afro. Plenty of damage dealt there.
Ooh. Middle of the floor.
Damage up and across to him. Hit up Pulverize, run away. Javelin coming across. GBM does not land the damage.
Oh,
but he tried to chase. And he's just looking for Aphromoo. Can he get the rest of it? E comes across. No, he's going to get executed. Xmithie takes him down. Darshan running. Thanks to a stun, buys some time for himself. Stixxay.
Curtain call.
No Iceborne yet. And now, smack, 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 and smack on Darshan. But they're going to live.
Wow. So, yeah. CLG end up getting a kill there, and a lot of summoner spells too. Mm-hmm. They got the flash out of GBM. Okay, so I guess it's just that one, and the TP of Quas, which can be important. And Kiwikid!
Oh no, he's recalling on a brush on a ward.
Pings it afterwards.
Unlucky.
There's a ward here. And Darshan actually played that previous fight really well as well. His Counter-Strike ended up stopping him from dying.
Yeah, two-man stun and blocked a lot of damage before it, too. Definitely good by him. Stixxay walks over some...
It's a garden!
Right?
And he takes no damage.
Yeah, it looks like Stixxay doesn't like the show. He was not a captive audience at all in any of those.
He wants his money back.
Yep. Wants the refund. Makes fun of some popular movie that isn't actually good. I'll refrain from judgment. Everyone can pick their own example. Star Wars Episode 2. It's a popular one to hate, right?
Yeah, that one and one.
Yeah.
Especially
that one was okay.
What?
Really? I don't remember. It's so long ago, right?
It's the one with Jar Jar.
Hey.
A lot of Jar Jar. Two out of two.
Okay, okay. He's secretly a Sith Lord, man. Come on.
I saw that.
Yes. It's a great conspiracy theory.
There's actually a...
Oh, no. We're going down this rabbit hole?
It just... Random. There's
okay.
There's a guy out there who did edits of the first few ones, the
yeah,
Phantom edit.
Mm-hmm.
Fantastic. I actually understood what was going on in that movie because they cut out all of the superfluous things. They mm-hmm. cut out like a lot of Jar Jar. They cut out a lot of the Trade Federation talking and only give you like
you
the
cut
one
out Jar Jar?
Point.
I'm just kidding.
Okay. No.
I'm not treating Jar Jar the way I treat Teemo. Teemo's actually awesome. I'm not jumping on that.
Yeah, if you want to like episode one, you watch the Phantom edit.
Okay. Thank you for that information.
Yeah, all see right, that one guy out there. Thank you. You're welcome.
It was actually him who made it. Whoa.
I want his autograph.
Okay. Well, there you go. See him up for the show.
Anyway.
He'll just lie to you.
Yomu's Ghostblade completed for
yeah.
OQ.
Still no Iceborne yet for Stixxay. He's actually going for everything else first, really. Manamune's nice. Attack's mm-hmm. been faster that way, and he's going to have more attack damage. Be more sort of generally damaging, but no slow fields.
With the Sunfire Cape first, not the Ravenous Hydra, goes for the item that's going to help him a little bit against the Jax. It's going to constantly shove waves back, but...
I think now it's Satanic next. He's got the double longsword. Is Satanic mm-hmm. or... Like, there's a chance it's Ruin King, though I doubt it.
I mean, that's the Duelist build there.
Yeah. Well, I mean, if he goes Sunfire, actually, then he has the wave clear of sorts, so I can see that actually being the lineup for him. See what it ends up being. Looks like CLG pressuring towards the top side. HuHi down alone. And look at this Karma flanking behind. He's got to start backing up because energy heading down. But the call was made and he will back out. This Ryze will stay alive for now. Santorin says, yep, there's not even a jungle to kill.
They got
to
kill this turret though because they're going to lose their top side.
Yeah, so energy made a rotation and they hope they can knock the turret down because top lane tier 2 is already gone. CLG made that play and reinforced Darshan.
And now they're going to rotate mid.
CLG. Yeah, CLG faster on the play by a lot. GBM's not even doing any damage yet. Energy is significantly slower.
But it's also Lissandra. Like, Lissandra's not going to kill this that quickly.
This doesn't do anything. Why are you even casting this spell right now? It's a waste of the ultimate for OQ. He like half damages two minions.
This kills the caster.
Doesn't even do that.
It doesn't
They're
kill
all full
the,
health.
I know, the caster minions, no.
It just hurt me.
They just gave up. Yeah, exactly.
I played Jhin some. That hurt. I would have done that. OQ, step up your game.
That's a desperation call, though. That
is
him saying, I need to do something here because we are getting outplayed on the map. They just got two turrets for free. For free. And energy need to answer back in some way if they want to stay in this game.
Well, much like the Empire, they'll try to, but not enough energy can make this one happen right now. They're falling behind now. 2.3 thousand gold. They're less than 8 minutes away from when game one already ended. And CLG making this game look a bit similar. Yeah, early game, back and forth, some nice moves by energy, and then you hit that 15-minute mark, and then everything comes collapsing down.
Map play, immediate.
Map play, just smashing these guys right now. OQ just plays some wave clear. Here's what he can, but yeah, we're just not seeing them make those rotations. Those aren't crisp, but they have some good matchups. Again, like you're seeing, HuHi had to run, screaming, fleeing away from GBM. Okay, I lost a minion wave. Two turrets died. Well, guess that was fine. And like the one good match for CLG is doing twice as much as the two good matches of energy. I mean, at this point, I guess you could consider like Jhin Karma is no longer great against Ezreal like Alistar, but still, like, you've got one obvious lead on each side, and CLG's making it work and energy isn't. And it's props to CLG, sure. Like, we can go on the positive side of this one and say, hey, that's a nice rotation. That's a nice play, right? You
played
two champions, lost nothing, still pushed mid. Like, that's good. That's solid play by CLG, absolutely.
Yeah.
Right? We're seeing, like, decent stuff by them.
They didn't see the inevitable Jax push in the top lane, reaching that tier two and being able to destroy it. It looked like they wanted to make a play down bottom onto HuHi because he was way too far forward.
Yeah.
And when he backed up, he canceled out that opportunity.
Yeah.
Made it so they'd have to dive him, but that top turret was already going to go down and they weren't even on it. So the CLG just playing the map spread out and it's working for them. They play the 1-3-1 and it's old CLG style, but it's what works for them, especially against teams like NRG who don't seem to be able to handle it.
Yeah, and I'm actually curious to see how CLG ends up playing later on. Oh, hold on, a battle. Who he flashed away, takes plenty of damage, but does he have anywhere to go? Actually, he's totally fine because Alistar was roaming down and looks like NRG couldn't commit to the play. Looking at Quas trying to fight Darshan. That doesn't look great for Quas, though, honestly, as Darshan just leaps around, kills some minions off, and his turret takes basically no damage. But you are seeing him respect Quas. Like, look how far back Darshan's playing. He's not even last hitting. He's actually aware of how this matchup kind of looks for him right now.
This is really bad for NRG because when you're getting 1-3-1'd and your solo laners can't hold, then you're slowly bleeding objectives. Your mid lane as well, they have poke against kind of poke because it's an Ezreal, a Karma, and an Alistar. There's a lot of healing here, and you can just actually play trench warfare and just keep poking. And if they poke back with like a Karma or something like that, then you just heal it up, and they have no ways to really do that.
Ocean Drake, Infernal Drake, the Siege Dream, if you're actually trying to get rid of champions, supposed to just knock the turret down themselves. Bot lane tier two goes down, make that now 5-2 in that score line. A headbutt pulverize to go right back on a Kiwikid. Stixxay, no, man, nice shot. Takes another Mystic, and now it's OQ running at 500 HP, flashing away from the Mystic shot as well. Another turret goes down.
Smithy's gonna try to go after him. Oh.
Yeah, and he's not gonna get much else done. Has to run away from the threat of the Nidalee, and Aphromoo didn't have to ult or flash or do anything. CLG smashing right now. Missing on OQ, but that's okay because Counterlogic Gaming in absolute control right now. More resources, they take down a second Ocean Drake.
Exactly what they want.
Honestly, yeah, if you're playing the Siege game, so standing on the map forever, actually really good for them.
Yeah, and it also means that Jax can just split push, back up a little bit, maybe even do Krugs, and he heals.
Right, you can now sustain a Trundle potentially. What a nice shot by Stixxay.
Really well positioned shot there, and you could see that Darshan was keeping tabs on Quas. So Quas couldn't even TP into that. He would have gotten Counter-Struck.
Exactly. Turn on Counter-Struck. You got 3.5 seconds, 4 seconds. I forget the number to jump in on that one. You have a 1 second lock out of the E. It's not a problem at all for a Jack to stop that.
It's 4.5 on live now.
Yeah, you're right. Which patch we're not on right now. So still 3.5 according to the tooltips that I've read. 5,000 now, nearly the gold lead.
Look for the play on the Darshan.
Okay, shields are on. Four members up there. Jumps over the pillar, but oh, nice, a flash. And he gets away, and four people is what that took.
Yep, the leap strike and then the flash away. Kiwikid had actually flashed preemptively because of the previous time it happened. If he had flashed, he would have been able to tether Darshan, so he does it this time, but it's just, boom, leap strike right out of range.
Yep, so a trade of flash is not the worst situation for Darshan as the rest of CLG has pushed in many of the waves, mid lane right up against the inhibitor yet again, as GBM trades the clearing back and forth. Bot lane actually uncontested right now, but we are seeing HuHi walk over there. 0-0-1 on him, just farming up, being the sort of standard insurance policy. A low kill game is just simply map plays, and players mostly knowing what they can and can't get away with, happy to trade summoners if they need to. Attempt to engage. Oh, a nice arcane ship, but they still got onto Stixxay. That should be a kill as Aphro can block all the damage. Stixxay continues to run, and he gets away with it. Aphro doesn't even die either. True Shot Barrage comes across, and into the back line went HuHi. That's good picked up by him, as well as Darshan. And the teleport's coming through, working wonderfully. Second kill comes through as GVM has dropped off the face of the map. Quas going to be another kill picked up, a 3-0 CLG. Just do not misstep, and NRG can't catch a break.
And NRG have to back off. Baron looks like it's in the eyes of CLG right now. 22 minutes in, we're seeing Baron at about the same time as last game. We're seeing them rip the game wide open and taking a gigantic lead at about the same time. 17, 15 minutes comes around and CLG just starts playing the map way better than NRG, and NRG just look lost. They don't know how to answer these turrets, and it just creates this type of game. And once again, There's no Cloud Drake for you. Same game.
Nope, we're okay, but... Poor NRG, man.
The more things look better and better for this squad, the worse they actually seem to perform, because this is one of their lowest game times. They've been able to stall a lot of matchups, even against teams that are higher in the standings, right? They took a game off of Immortals and Envy, I believe.
Right.
And they weren't able to continue that type of performance. And those were in week one and two.
Yeah, it's gotten almost progressively worse. The sad thing is after they just take everything up with the ultimate. Watch the replay here. And GVM tried to go back in. I mean, he got so close to killing Aphromoo, right?
Yeah.
And some of these were really, really close. There were some really tight fights. Some of it was just getting heavily outplayed macro-wise. Some of it is, like, unlucky. Like, you do that fight three more times, NRG probably wins it half the time. But, you know, good claps by CLG. The double teleport, one of their trademark plays, came into the back line, knocked down Santorin, cleaned up GVM. And here we are, CLG getting farther and farther ahead.
Yeah, they're looking to get their record back on track because they came back from MSI. Expectations were high. I saw some power rankings that were like, these guys are good. They're going to be number one, or Immortals are going to be number one, and CLG's number two.
Sure,
it's
that
like,
was the goal.
They are number seven right now.
Yeah. But you talk about Immortals, that's going to be actually the final opponent on the first round for Apex, who would then be sitting at 4-5 if they lose that match. CLG is in a tie for sixth at the end of the day. We assume, based on the way games are going and the way the teams look, and, well, CLG's back in a playoff position. They run the back half of the split, look a whole, you know, look a little bit better.
Yeah.
Start contesting those teams, and CLG are at least in the playoffs.
It's funny because they were talking about how we don't understand the meta. It's like, we got to get this down, and they're still just playing the same things as before. It's still comfort for them. Like,
and I don't mind that.
And that's fine. I actually think that's fine, as long as you're able to play some of those champions and make them banned against you or a threat, right? If you just don't play those, then it's a problem. You get to put time in on them, and then you just find the strategy that works for you, but still have the threat of running what's standard.
Right, you've got sort of a situation where there are objectively strong champions that kind of need to be dealt with in champ select in some way, but the style in which you use them is entirely up to you. Oh, this is gonna be bad though. Double stun comes in, Kiwikid's gone already. How about a re-engage as well? Quas rooted up in place. Damage coming through, picked off by Darshan yet again. 2-0 on him, GBM. Self ults, he's got nowhere to go. Papazoni is buying a few more seconds, but it should still be a kill on the mid laner. A double kill for Darshan, just making sure the cleanup happens. 10-3 in kills, and about 40 seconds slower than game one. Counter Logic Gaming are gonna win this match 2-0 in just over 50 minutes. An absolute slaughter, giving up 5 kills total, giving up, I believe, 4 turrets total, giving up almost nothing the entire series long. CLG cementing that they do not belong at the bottom of the table as they dismantle NRG Esports.
And they've now beaten